The current leader pledged allegiance to ISIS. The people that we spoke to talked about killing. They talked about bombings using women and children. ISIS has declared official jihad against the Nigerian government, but also against the United States government. ISIS targets politicians. They target clerics for assassination. Many pastors have been killed. And ISIS focus on symbols of Western advancement, such as schools, hospitals, and churches, and suicide attacks. And there's a great fear. They use their own motorbikes. If you've been there, there are motorbikes all over. There are drive-by by shootings. We visited areas where almost the entire village was destroyed, and yet God bless the people, their faith. Let me tell you, if the faith of the Nigerian people is incredible, they have stayed. Thousands of girls, we're going to talk about the Chibok girls a little bit later, but thousands of women and girls have been abducted by Boko Haram. I urge you to read the Washington Post piece on Monday. It was an incredible piece, and God bless the photographer, the author who went there to kind of root that out, because the insecurity in the area, it's a very difficult area to travel around. We talked with individuals involved with the Chibok girls. As you know, it took place in April. This April 14th and 15th will be the second anniversary next week. It's in the Borno State. They were all Christian girls, and few, if any, and it's a debatable thing, which others may have opinion, few, if any, have been released. Maybe one, maybe two, but it's hard to actually say. And some have, when we were there, it was before the I saw an interview on CNN a week ago, we were told none had been released. One counselor who meets with the families said the families are told the following. He said, one, many of the girls, and I have four daughters, many of the girls may never return. Secondly, they will have been raped over and over and over and over and over and over. Read the Washington Post piece on Monday. It is brutal, and for the world to stand by and do nothing, it's frightening. Thirdly, many will be pregnant or with child, and some will have HIV. And lastly, and these are all Christian girls, he said many or most will have converted to Islam as a result of forced conversion. You may remember on that time that Michelle Obama delivered the weekly White House address assuring Americans and Nigerians everything possible would be done for the girls. And it was a great program, hashtag bring back our girls. It meant well, but there have been no tangible results. And while at that time the families were relieved to see that America was involved, the president was involved, and everyone was interested, I think there's a great sense of disappointment now that here we're coming up to a two-year anniversary and none have been released. There's another terrorist group, which you very seldom hear about here in the United States, the Fulani Militant Herdsmen, radical Islamic groups. They are nomadic. There are 20 million out in the region. There are Nigeria, Guinea, Mali, Niger, Cameroon, Chad, and even some in Sudan. We heard over and over, though, about the Fulani herdsmen coming in, and sometimes we actually heard more about the Fulanis than we actually heard about Boko Haram. Not that we didn't hear about Boko Haram, but we also heard a lot about the Fulanis. When we were in Nigeria that week, the village Agatu was attacked. The reports were it went on for several days. 200 to 300 or more were killed. Two of the reports said that the attackers used helicopters. Others said they were police helicopters. But helicopters, 2 or 3 days, something's wrong. Something's wrong there. There are thousands and thousands of internally displaced persons living in camps that are grim, depressing, poor housing, burlap bags separating room after room, little food. But yet I would again want to come back to what I said before. Many of them have very strong faith. In fact, one pastor said, not complaining. He says, you evangelized us, the West, in 1904, and now we look to see what's taking place in the church in the West. And frankly, I don't think they want any part of what they're seeing. Their faith is very strong. To wrap up, some recommendations. One, the U.S. must put pressure to deal with the corruption issue. In fairness, President Buhari has said that he will deal with this, and he has done some positive things. And wherever there is positive activity, I think they have to be rewarded and commended. There should also be human rights training for the military and for the police. We would go into a village, and they would say the police came in and they were open firing, or people in uniforms came in and open firing. Now, was it the military, was it the police, or was it the Boko Haram just got uniforms and dressed up? But you really need to do almost what the U.S. government did down in Colombia with regard to the military and FARC. And it may bump up to the Leahy Amendment. Senator Leahy is a good guy, and I know why the Leahy Amendment's there. I supported it when I was in Congress. But perhaps there should be a waiver whereby you could have human rights training for the police and for the military. Thirdly, we believe the Western churches here should really have relationships and liaison with the West, with the churches in Nigeria, the Catholic Church here in the United States, the Baptist Church here in the United States, the Anglican Church. I called one Anglican pastor, John Yates, and boy, he acted like that and did something to help Bishop Kouachi the other day. And so I think if you had a coordinating council of American churches to directly with their counterparts in Nigeria, that would be very, very helpful. We need to aid the people in the IDP camps. You just can't let that go on. I mean, the World Food Program, somebody really has to come in there and perhaps bring in a group like World Vision or Save the Children or Samaritan's Purse, but to really kind of organize these camps and aid them. You need a program to aid the women who have been captured and who have been freed. When you read the Washington Post piece, sometimes they are the victims twice. They're the victims when they're kidnapped and they're raped and abused over and over. And then when they're freed, their village does not want them back. There is a stigma. And I think the same thing needs to be done, as Luann was saying the other day. Also, we need a program for the men who are captured. Luann and I went to the prisons. We were in the prisons two different times. One day they said they were going to let us see some Boko Haram people. Then they said, well, the visiting hours ended. Come back tomorrow. We came back tomorrow, and they shut us down. There are Boko Haram people in the prisons, and you need programs to make sure they come out and do not go back. I would personally like to see IJM. Gary Hogan has done an incredible job. Shared Hope, Linda Smith, former congresswoman from Oregon, and the Polaris organization that fights sexual trafficking in the United States to go over to Nigeria and see and aid them in setting up a program, because we owe it, particularly if we're going to do this bring back the girls. When they come back, they need counseling, they need training. So I think IJM, Shared Hope, and Polaris ought to do that, because the women are victims twice. I also personally believe that we need a special envoy for West Africa including Nigeria. I had urged the Bush administration, and God bless President Bush, he did it, to appoint somebody special envoy for Sudan. He put Senator John Danforth in, because if you recall, Sudan had the North and the South, and had Kenya was involved a little bit, Somalia was a little bit involved, Ethiopia was a little bit involved, Uganda was a little bit involved, and so to bring everybody together. And so I believe that a special envoy located in the State Department, because right now the poor Nigerians, when they come here, really don't know where to go. Do they go to the FBI for terrorism, or who sets that meeting up? Or do they go over to the DOD for this? So I think a special envoy, certainly in the office of either Rabbi Saperstein or in the office of the Assistant Secretary, but a one-stop person who will advocate. And also, as you know, the Congress passed a special envoy to advocate for the persecuted church in the Middle East, including Pakistan and Iran. And Knox Thames has done an incredible job. To have somebody like that to be a contact point, because you now have, and this is not meant as criticism, American embassies are sort of stovepipe. The embassy will look after what's taking place in their country. But you have Nigeria, you have Guinea, you have Mali, you have Niger, you have Chad, you have Cameroon. And so you need to have one place, and I think a special envoy for West Africa / Nigeria would be a very positive thing. Lastly, we have to aid the Nigerian military. I mean, they need advisors. They need training. They need intel sharing. They need the use of drones to see what's taking place. I happen to think that 200 young women somewhere, whether it be in the Zambezi or forest or what, we should be able to find them. We should be able to find them. So I think there ought to be – we should be aiding the military. And as you all know, there is the multinational group around her. Lastly, I think it's important that we educate the American people. This is an issue of terrorism. It's an issue of violation of human rights, religious freedom. It's an issue of corruption. It's so many other things. And there are a million, I was told, Nigerian living here in America. This should be an issue that we care deeply about. So I think to educate, I realize it's very difficult for the press to move around there, but to educate them. And with that, I just kind of end. And thank you again for having this.
Thank you, Mr. Wolf. You know, as Mr. Wolf reflected on the faith of the Nigerian people, I can't help but think of the story I heard from a woman named Damaris Atson. She is someone in Nigeria who suffered as a Christian, and she has a tremendous story of faith. The organization Open Doors has put together a short video with her. You can find it on YouTube. I encourage you to go there, find this video. It just shows someone's faith under tremendous stress and persecution. It's an inspiration to me. Seeing this fellow sister in the Lord in Nigeria standing strong for God. This type of thing is invaluable to creating an understanding between churches across borders and something that will strengthen the faith behind the need to protect religious freedom. On Nigeria, I also want to point out that we have with us today in the audience Emmanuel Ogebe over there. He's done a lot of great work on Nigeria. Feel free to stick around after the presentation to talk more to Emmanuel, anyone else you want to connect with, and our panelists will be here afterwards, even after the formal questioning. Next, we're going to move on to Rafique, Pervez Rafique from Pakistan. He's a former Pakistani member of parliament, longtime activist on the issue of religious freedom in Pakistan. I recently met him and have really gotten to enjoy getting to know him and hear his stories and the great work he's doing there. I think his work needs to be encouraged. So I'm going to allow him to share a little bit on what's going on there.
Thank you very much. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim that captives will be released, that the blind will see, and that the oppressed will be set free. Amen. Dear friends, good afternoon, and God bless you. It's a great honor for me to review the situation of religious liberty in Pakistan at such a high-level forum and with experienced panelists. As a believer, I first thank God who make this possible through Family Research Council. Especially I thank to Mr. Tervis, who gave me opportunity to speak about the religious persecution and discrimination we face, we feel, and fight against as religious minority communities in Pakistan, especially being a believers. It's a privilege for me to honor a stalwart defender, a champion of the religious freedom, Congressman Frank Wolf. I salute you, sir, on behalf of my organization, Bleeding for Belief, my community and country, for your extraordinary, tremendous, and remarkable services you did for religious freedom and promotion of human rights, especially as an author of International Religious Freedom Act and for the legislation to create a U.S. State Department special envoy to advocate for religious minorities in Near East Asia and Central South Asia. I also appreciate and thank for the services of Dr. Thomas Farr and Tina for the promotion of religious freedom, peace, and human rights values. A friend of Iran, an enemy of Israel, Islamic Republic of Pakistan, religious liberty situation is very alarming, dangerous, and much worse in the world. According to Global Index, Pakistan stood on number 5 in world religious freedom violations. A country of 95% Muslims, one of the most hostile nations for the religious minorities. It's in the top five overall restriction on the religious, singling out its anti-blasphemy statutes. Religious minorities, especially Christians, are segregated, discriminated, neglected, killed, burned, and put behind the bars frequently, and always under severe threat mentally and physically. A recent attack and slaughtering of Christians on Resurrection Day in Lahore, the exile of thousands of Christians and other minorities groups in Thailand, Malaysia, Sri Lanka, India, after fleeing from Pakistan to save their children and their lives, who now are suffering as refugees, asylum seekers, or illegal immigrants, itself speaks the worst situation of Pakistani Christians and other religious minority groups. Another terrible side is that on Easter Day, March 27-26, religious extremist organization hold procession in the capital of Pakistan in favor of Mumtaz Qadri, the murderer of Suleiman Taseer, to declare assassin Mumtaz Qadri a hero of Islam, which shows the religious extremists' strong network in Pakistan, and on other hand, it shows failure of law enforcement agencies and the absence of it of the government. The protesters disperse on fourth day with the assurance, commitment, and agreement from the federal government on following demands, sources said. What are the demands? Government should hang Asia Bibi, a Christian woman falsely accused in blasphemy law. Government should declare officially Mumtaz Qadri a hero, martyr of Islam. Government should withdraw the cases and allegations against the protesters. Government will not make any changes in blasphemy laws and other Islamic discriminatory laws. No operation against religious organizations and madrasas. One can analyze the future of Pakistan. We feel that this secret agreement encouraged the extremist militant organizations, increased religious extremism in the country, and insecure the lives, places of worship, and properties of its minorities, especially Christians, and their life is on the mercy of extremists. The present situation of country and its religious minorities is miserable. And right now, it is not a matter of religious freedom only. It's a matter of life and death. It's a matter of their safety and security more than anything else. Blasphemy laws 295A, BC is a naked sword on the neck of its minorities, and courts frequently use such laws to give death sentences to minorities accused of insulting Islam or its prophet due to pressure and threats from extremist organizations. Often their crime is as simple as openly professing their faith. A study on Pakistan from United States Commission for International Freedom counted more than 200 attacks among religious groups and 1,800 casualties resulting from religion-related violence between 2012 to 2013, one of the highest rates in the world. The persecution isn't limited to Christians. All religious minorities in Pakistan face daily reminders of their plights, including discriminatory laws, forced conversions, incident of rape, kidnapping of Hindus and Christian girls, and bomb shooting aimed to minority sects, especially Muslims such as Shiat and Ahmadis. Discrimination in education and professional institute on the basis of faith, which minority students face in other way to stop their development as a community. The result, if you see, that out of 6 to 7 million Christians of Pakistan, we don't have even 100 of doctors, even 100 of PhD engineers, or even IT experts, because the religious discrimination and lack of equal opportunities and resources. Economically, minorities are less privileged, especially Christians are the poorest among all. They stuck on the lower rung of the economy, often working as servants, sweepers, public cleaners, and daily laborers. There is no businessman in Christians which can play their role to boost them economically. Things has gone from bad to worse to very much worse. They have been discriminated constitutionally and legally, socially and politically, educationally and economically in every walk of life. ISIS wants to implement a strict form of Sharia law. It wants to wipe out various sects. It labels those who don't support them infidels. It encourages jihad against West. It makes videos of brutal killings and beheadings. and uses social media for propagation. Those who are aware of Pakistan dynamics can very well see that already several organizations with such aims and objectives have been functional in Pakistan. Al-Qaeda, which leads the jihadis of Pakistan and Afghanistan, Pakistani jihadis landscape occupied by two mainstreams, the Afghan Taliban and Al-Qaeda. The third most important organization is Tehrik-e-Taliban Pakistan, TTP, which operates solely in Pakistan. There are some state-sponsored jihadis like Jamaat-ud-Dawa and Jaish-e-Muhammad. They are fully controlled and used for our foreign policy objectives in Kashmir, India, and Afghanistan. Pakistan presently a state at war and highly influenced by religious extremist and terrorist organizations. In recent Pew survey, 57% singled out religious conflicts as a major national problem, and some are taking matters in their own hands. Due to lack of political will, fear, weak strategy, and non-seriousness of the governments and its institutes, Pakistan, as a state, severely violates the International Charter, Universal Declaration for Human Rights, and ICCPR. Its present situation as a state is also against the constitution, policies, and principle of United States of America. The Yusuf from 2002 recommendation to US State Department to put Pakistan on CPC, Country of Particular Concerns for Religious Freedom Violations. Minorities and progressive leadership of the country due to fear and severe life threats keep silence, especially after the assassination of Governor Soleiman Taseer and Christian Federal Minister Minority Shahbaz Bhatti, martyr, my colleague and my friend. But they are now speaking in the international media through religious and human rights organizations. They feel foreign diplomatic pressure from US as a political ally and sources of aid to the nation, and global religious leaders can strengthen the climate for minorities in Pakistan. A more tolerant Pakistan would translate into another goal for many less tolerance for terrorists and extremists. Now, the question is what action America as state and American as its citizens, and especially church leaders as believers and other stakeholders, can take to play their vital role and effective role to promote and protect religious liberty, peace, and how they can contribute for the development of Christians and other marginalized communities, especially relating to their security and stability. Bleeding for Belief recommended and urged that falling action from American government, political, religious, and civil society leaders and organizations to secure believers and religious minorities communities in Pakistan for their protection and promotion. Number one, protecting and promoting the religious freedom is key objective of US foreign policy. America as country increase build diplomatic pressure on Pakistan to achieve its key objective. Number two, America as a state act according to its policies and principles in lieu and recommendation of United States Commission for International Freedom about Pakistan. America should encourage, equip, and empower progressive leadership in Pakistan to make Democratic Republic of Pakistan form theocratic state, Islamic Republic of Pakistan. America should condition its aid to Pakistan and ask Pakistan to take concrete and practical steps for the promotion of religious freedom and for the protection of religious minorities. America can demand repealment of all discriminatory laws and abolish all biased articles from the Constitution of Pakistan, which violates Universal Declaration, ICCPR, the basic and equal human rights of its citizen, on the basis of religion, gender, color, or caste. America should demand from Pakistan to eliminate and curb the militant and the extremist organization network actively functioning their operation in Pakistan. Ask to honor international charter and American policies and principles. American government should allocate special funds on human basis to uplift marginalized and deprived religious minority communities of Pakistan and utilize these funds through civil society organization. American religious, educational and business, media and civil society, international and national organizations step forward to stop the slaughtering of believers and contribute passionately and professionally and financially for their development, educationally, economically, by keeping in mind that we are a part of one body in Christ Jesus as head. If one part of body suffers, whole body suffers. Americans should speak, stand, and support for the persecuted Christians to liberate them from religious hate and extremism, illiteracy, and poverty, to promote culture of love, peace, hope, and harmony. Thanks for your attention, and we hope for your actions. May God bless all who works to glorify his name and stand with Pakistani Christians and other persecuted communities and believers around the world. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Pervez. We appreciate your perspective on Pakistan. Our last two speakers are going to focus slightly different ways with different angles on the situation in the Middle East and religious freedom there. I'm going to allow Tina Ramirez to speak first, and then Dr. Tom Farr, who slipped in previous to the last session. We're glad he's joining us. He'll go last, then we'll take questions. I've had the pleasure of knowing Tina for quite some time. She's been a longtime advocate in the field of international religious freedom, working on the Hill and with the U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom. She's also worked for the Beckett Fund for Religious Liberty on their efforts in this area. And now she's the president and founder of, or executive director of, Hardwired Global. And Hardwired is doing some really important training right now, bolstering the right and the understanding, a proper understanding of the right of international religious freedom around the world. So I'll let Tina take it from here and talk a little bit more about that.
Thank you. Can we stand up there? Is it okay? Is that one on?
If you like. Yeah. Is it okay if we have someone stand up there? I don't know if it'll catch it.
Okay. I have a lot of pages to turn. I don't want you to see them all. Although I might have forfeited your opportunity to see me, so. Now, how many of you have your driver's license with you today? I'd like for you to take it out, please. Hold it up. Mine's down there. I'll grab it, too. I promise this will be a valuable lesson. You see, I used to be a teacher before I came to Washington, and it ruined me, so. All right, what is the one thing, as a man or woman, you try to hide on your ID card? Your age, or you typically it's, you know, men try to increase their height and women decrease their weight, right? Okay, well, whatever it is. See, but what is not on our ID cards? Religion, right? In most of the world, that's what identifies you. And if you get in trouble, that's usually what they look to. In some countries, though, you don't actually have a choice of how they identify you. And what I want to talk about today is Iraq and the fact that they don't have the identity that they would choose for themselves, and how we're working to help them change that, and how you have actually been a part of that. So many of you know recently that there was a genocide resolution that was passed in Congress and the president finally acknowledged. I'm not going to talk much about that because Dr. Farr is going to. But what I do want to say is that we all recognize that religious oppression around the world, and in Iraq in particular, is extremely bad. We heard it in Nigeria, we heard it in Pakistan, and in Iraq we finally have called it genocide. This means that it's reached such a level of atrocity that human lives, whole religious communities, are simply being wiped out. And to give you an idea, when I started working in Iraq about 10 years ago, you had about a quarter of the Christian population left in Iraq after the U.S.-led war over there. Now, that population is about half of that. Half of them have, of those that were left, have even left the country. And the other half, they actually live in refugee or displacement camps within the country. Or they're housed with other families of Christians, and they're all huddled together trying to just survive in this country. So when you think about genocide, you think about the fact that in Iraq today, these communities are simply being wiped out. Now, the Yazidis, on their ID card, it actually says that they're Muslim. Many Christian converts, Muslim. Jews, Muslim. Kakai, Muslim. And if you go down and down and down the line, they can't identify as themselves. They have to identify as someone else. Now they've been practically wiped off the map, and what's next? So if you watch the news today, you can see religious oppression all over. it's right at our front door, essentially. Last year, when I met with Congressman Wolf, there were about 150 to 200 Americans that had gone to join ISIS to fight in Iraq against this genocide that we see playing out right now. That number has doubled just in the last year alone. It's something that we can't get away from. We can't avoid. And as Americans, we take religious freedom for granted so often, but we realize more and more that we live in a globalized world. These people are our brothers and sisters, and we really can't afford to ignore it. One, because they're coming from our own neighborhood now and going and committing these atrocities against people in our own faith community. And that's a pretty frightening thought. Last year, Hardwired brought a young girl to the U.S., and Congressman Wolf actually had a chance to meet her and helped us launch a formal prosecution with the FBI of the man that had held her captive in Iraq and Syria. She was held by an American that had fought with ISIS. Yeah, that's how close to home this has gotten. So now what I want to do is share a little bit about what we're doing in Iraq, because I don't want you to leave with this sense of, like, this is really bad, because it is. But there's something that we can do together and that we are doing to help change that trajectory so that people don't have to hide who they are anymore in Iraq. Because none of us would want to live hiding who we are here in America, would we? At Hardwired, our mission is to make it possible for more people to experience religious freedom, and that's a pretty big goal. The problems are complex, and they require a lot of complex solutions, as I'm sure you'll hear from some of the other panelists today. It's not easy overcoming religious oppression or genocide. So what we're doing is we're working with leaders in countries like Iraq, but also Nigeria, Sudan, and many other countries, and training them to defend themselves. Because after working in many years for Washington, I realized that often policy comes too late. The genocide recognition has come after they're almost all gone. And if we don't want that to happen again, or continue to happen in Iraq, then we have to do something to make it possible for them to have the strength to do something right where they are. Now let me, since Dr. Farr is going to share a little bit about the situation in Iraq under the genocide, I don't want to share what you can see in the news and what he's going to share. What I want to share is kind of a behind-the-scenes look of what you're not seeing. And this is something that actually Travis had the opportunity to be a part of last September when he went to Iraq to participate in a training for Hardwired. What we did in this past year is we worked with the British government to bring together 60 leaders from different religious communities throughout Iraq. These are people that never usually hang out together. Kakai, Shabak, Muslim Brotherhood leaders, Christians, Yazidis, people all across the board. And maybe you wouldn't hang out with any of them either. But we brought together some pretty interesting characters. And for the first time in Iraq's history, they came together to talk about religious freedom. Now, in the past, they might have talked about minority rights. But we don't want them to see themselves as a minority. We want to see themselves in a position of power and authority as equal citizens of the country that they are the only reason we'll ever survive if it gets through this. So we brought them together and we began to train them in what religious freedom is, this freedom that we all love and why you're all here today to support. Now, they don't know what their rights are. They've been struggling to say, we're minorities, we deserve some piece of this pie, of this future of our country. And we explained to them the rights that they have, the dignity that they have. And in that, they were empowered. They came to respect one another. They began to think differently about themselves and about the other. For instance, some Muslim Brotherhood leaders that we had in our training, yes, I'm sure that sends chills through your spine, but in the beginning, it did through ours as well. They came to our training thinking that it was completely okay to implement Sharia law on everybody in the training and in the country. This is post-ISIS, and of course, they were nothing like ISIS, but they had the same mentality that that was perfectly okay and justified. And through the training, by working with other Muslims that were in the training, Christians, Yazidis, and where they were forced to hear the experiences that they had, where they were forced to consider their own biases and fears and misconceptions, at the end, they came to realization that maybe not just Christians and Yazidis deserve rights, but maybe even atheists deserve rights. Now, I'm telling you that's a huge, huge leap for a Muslim Brotherhood person to not just defend Christians, but atheists, okay? This was huge. What happened was that he had a perspective shift. He had a conceptual change in his mind, and that's what we're working towards at Hardwired. If people cannot change their own minds and thoughts about other people, they will never be able to defend religious freedom properly, and we will continue to have the problems in Iraq that we see today. That's just one example of what happened. But as their perspective shifted, they began to realize that together they could actually make a difference in their country. So now, a year later, we have 60 leaders who we were just with a month ago that have come together to start working together and implement religious freedom programs within their communities all over Iraq. This is amazing, okay? We should all be saying amen. This is amazing. For the first time in Iraq's history, you have people defending religious freedom for one another. How many of you would like to see that in America? Okay? Do we have people of different faiths and perspectives, people on other sides of the podium, working together in America today on religious freedom? No. But in Iraq today, you do. Not only that, you have the government leaders helping support it. So we had the head imam writing fatwas, yes, religious edicts in Kurdistan, join our training, and now he's going out and talking about it in his mosque sermons. And then the two leaders that are helping rewrite all the Islamic education in Kurdistan were part of our training. They were so excited, they've already started teaching their students and incorporating into the curriculum that all students of Islamic studies will go through, incorporating religious freedom. That's exciting. Okay, this is because we brought them together, we forced them to go through a program that made them change their perspectives about one another. They did not feel comfortable in the beginning, and I can tell you, if you have someone sitting next to you, or that you're, you know, when you come to work or wherever you are, that has a different perspective from you, you know how uncomfortable that is, right? But we know that if we can't start there with ourselves and with changing the person next to us, and in that small circle, we will never have the ripple effect to affect the rest of society, right? And that's what we're trying to do in Iraq, because there are many problems in Iraq. Vian Dakhil, the leader of the parliamentary leader for the Yazidis in Iraq's parliament, said to me a year and a half ago, right after the genocide started, she said, Tina, if we had paid attention to religious freedom 10 years ago, like you were working on when you were working for the Congress, Congressman Wolf and others, the situation would look different. But we never made it a priority. It was never a red line for our government. It was never a red line for anyone else. Congressman Wolf used to harangued the administration, both Bush and Obama, please make this a red line. They never did they? And now we have the situation we have today. Look at Nigeria. But what I'm telling you is that if we had made it a priority, it would have looked different. That's what Vian Dekhil said. That's why we're investing today, because we know tomorrow will not look any different than today unless we begin somewhere. We know this because we did the same thing in Sudan. And one of the things Travis didn't mention, he was going to, but when Miriam Ibrahim, the pregnant woman from Sudan, was imprisoned, the only reason that she had people on the ground supporting her and defending her was because we had invested for several years training lawyers, journalists, and student leaders that came out. Many of them were Muslims that stood at her courthouse and protested and said, she deserves freedom. This is not Islam. Now, whatever you think Islam is or isn't, it really doesn't matter. We want that woman freed. We want her to stand for her rights. And we want people to say that this isn't whatever it is that's putting her there. That was a victory for her. Those victories can happen in Sudan, in Iraq, and even in America. But we have to begin to shift our own perspectives about what religious freedom is, who we work with, and how we get it done. And that's what Hardwired's working to do. There was a young, there was another member of our training, a judge. This judge was in charge of terrorism reparations and accountability. So he's the one that adjudicated their cases in Mosul. Yes, Mosul, part of Nineveh Plains, where genocide occurred. When it was happening, he had to flee. Well, after he fled, because he knew he would be one of the people targeted, his whole family was taken into custody. After he was a part of this training with us, he got a message from ISIS with a photo of his brother having his head chopped off, one of his youngest brothers. Why? Because how would he dare to be a judge and to try to have justice that goes against the Islamic State? Right after this training, though, what that judge had done, we were amazed by this man. I mean, top Islamic lawyer. He right after we finished, he was so moved by the training. He said, Tina, everybody in Iraq needs to go through this. If they would only go through it, our country would look different. We don't have a legal problem. We have a social and a cultural problem. People here, their minds need to change. He went and met the Yazidi leader that had just suffered this horrible genocide to just sit with him to apologize and to just be with him, to share humanity with him. And then the next time we saw him, he'd showed us that picture of his brother. It was pretty powerful. Now, this man, he's the one that may be in the Supreme Court in Baghdad someday. And if he is, he'll be standing in defense of people and religious freedom. And maybe one day, because currently under the law in Iraq, if you change, if you leave Islam and convert to a different religion, it's illegal. You can be put in prison. Well, that's the law today. But one day, we want that law to change. And what if that judge is then sitting on the bench? He'll see that that law is implemented correctly, the way it should be, the way religious freedom would say that it should be. Now, there are a lot of people in our training, people that had personally suffered. A Baha'i woman who on her ID card, it says she's a Muslim. All of these people want their freedom. And so last year, after some of our trainings, the Iraqi parliament was considering a law, the identity card law. And the ID card law was going to update the current law, but it was also going to add a provision, Article 26, that says that if your father or mother converts to Islam, then any children under 18 automatically will be identified as Muslim. This horrified the religious community across Iraq, because what about the Yazidi women that are coming back and are pregnant from ISIS? Will their children be forced to adopt an identity of the man that just tried to completely exterminate them? Is that part of the genocide policy? Is that something that the Iraqi government is endorsing now? But across the board, Kakai, Shabak, even Muslims that were with us were shocked and horrified. And so they worked together in a coalition to stop that law from passing in parliament last year. That the law went to the government. Many of you maybe signed petitions that that you saw on the internet about that. Maybe you tweeted to the president of Iraq. Because of that, the president sent the bill back to parliament and said, you need to revise this. I'm not signing it right now. But we have this window of opportunity. Now, maybe they wouldn't have known how to do that had they not been trained. I don't know. But that's why it's so important that we give them the tools that they need right now to defend themselves, because they're on the front lines. We're here. And it'll take us years to at Congress or anyone else to really do something. But we do need to work from that perspective. We just need to make sure they have the tools there as well. So right now, they're working to convince Parliament that they need to respect religious freedom and change the ID card so that whether they're a Jew and they've been living in hiding since the era of Saddam when they were forced to take on a Muslim identity, or a Yazidi that's just survived ISIS, or a Christian that's converted, or somebody else, that they deserve the identity that they choose. They deserve to be recognized by the faith of their choice, just like every other human being here and everywhere else in the world should have. So right now, you could actually be a part of that. You are the defenders of religious freedom. There aren't many in America. The ripples will be small, but the more and more of you that send a message to Baghdad or send a message to the president or to Congress that we care, that we stand with those Iraqis that want to be who they are, that want to stand for their faith, that you stand for that too, and that you want our Congress to do it, especially when we're sending millions and millions and billions in the past of dollars to support, to protect them from ISIS. If we want to say that genocide will only continue if they're denied their identity, you could do that. You could be a part of that. You could be a part of the future hope of the people of Iraq to be able to live out who they are and to have the freedom to worship just like you have here. What we do is just one small part. And sometimes at the end of these trainings, I ask the people we're working with, does it make a difference? I see what they do, and of course there's the encouragement, but sometimes I still wonder, like many of you might do when you share with a friend or you try to advocate or you sign a petition, does it matter? And one pastor in Sudan once told me after we trained him, he said, Tina, we know we'll be persecuted. We know it. It's biblical. But we know that we would rather die standing than lying down. And we want you to give us the ability to stand. So help us stand with us. And that's the same thing that whether they're a Sudanese pastor or there's somebody in Iraq that they're asking of you today. You are the frontline defenders here in America. You're the ones that are going to go out there and do something. And if that's the only thing you take away from my speech today, I hope that you will just simply do one thing today, because if you don't do it, who will? Thank you.
Thank you, Tina. I think we can all see that what Tina's doing is very important work. You know, one of the things that was very striking to me when I was over there was the conception of religious freedom that people have. You know, we think of it as attaching to our humanity because we're created in the image of God, including a robust manifestation of that religious freedom because it's our selection of what we choose to believe as a matter of one of our core human choices, regardless of what people may choose to believe. And this is reflected, you know, as a human right, it's reflected in the covenants, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, International Covenant, Civil and Political Rights, Article 18, holding beliefs and manifesting them. Domestically, free exercise is not just holding beliefs, but living them out neutrally between religions. This idea over there was very foreign to them. It was breaking through a wall that this could even be an idea of religious liberty. And so, you know, I think we can't underestimate the very elemental barriers that we need to break through to a conception of religious liberty as we're articulating here and as it needs to be protected around the world. Before questions, we'll have Dr. Tom Farr give us a presentation on some of the other related Middle East issues regarding the recent genocide designation and what the U.S. can do concretely to address that situation. Dr. Farr is a longtime advocate on this issue, also has extensive government experience in the State Department and elsewhere, and now he's the director of the Religious Freedom Project at the Berkeley Center for Religion, Peace, and World Affairs at Georgetown University. Dr. Farr, we're very thankful you're here today.
Thank you, Travis. Appreciate it. Mr. Rafique, it's a pleasure to meet you for the first time. It's always nice to be on a panel with heroes of yours, and Frank Wolf is a hero of my generation, if I might put it that way. He's somebody that I've admired for many, many years. It's also nice to have somebody that's a hero of your daughter's generation, and that's this young lady sitting next to me, who I've known for quite a while as well, and whose work is so important, and it's exciting to hear more about what Hardwired is doing. About which more in just a minute. I have a button which I often wear. Many of you have this or have seen it. It's the Arabic word or letter for N, meaning the word N for the word Nazarene. This is the letter that was painted on the doors of Christians. It was intended by ISIS as a slur, the Nazarenes, those who follow the Nazarene. So that they could be identified and slaughtered or captured and treated as ISIS treats its captives. What I want to talk to you about is saving Christians in Iraq, in Syria, and perhaps even more broadly, saving Christianity in Iraq and Syria. There are many reasons for standing for that goal. As a Christian, I don't apologize for wanting to save other Christians, to reduce their suffering, to stop their persecution, along with others who are targeted by ISIS as well. But saving Christianity has its own momentum, has its own rationale that I think is vitally important for its own sake. Christianity has made contributions. This is, in effect, next to the land of its birth. It's the land of its infancy. It is the land where the apostles walked. Historically, I think the case for saving a religion like Christianity or, frankly, others in this region has its own rationale. But I'd like to present a rationale that I think ought to be one that our own country, in a more secular way, can accept. And that is, I'll answer that by telling you the title of a speech of an event we had in Rome a few years ago. It was a three-day conference on Christian contributions to freedom. We had at my Georgetown outfit had funded scholars from around the world to write, to do research and write about Christian contributions historically and in the contemporary world of minorities, Christian minorities, Nigeria, China, elsewhere around the world, Sudan, of course, Iraq, Syria. Those volumes, by the way, from that study are now coming out. One is They're called Christianity and Freedom. Volume 2 actually came out first. That's the contemporary volume. Volume 1, the historical volume, will be out probably next week. This is Cambridge University Press, Christianity and Freedom. I highly recommend them. These are terrific books. But at one of the speakers was Archbishop Patriarch Sacco, the Patriarch of the Chaldeans. And this was pre-ISIS. The title of his speech was, "What Happens to the Middle East if Christians Flee? And the answer, it was a longer speech than this, but the answer was essentially twofold. First, the Christians suffer, and that was certainly a prescient understatement. But the second answer was the Middle East will suffer. The societies of Iraq and Syria will suffer. Not because, he said, Patriarch Sacco said, because Christians are somehow superior to other human beings or Christianity is a superior religion. Of course, those of us who adhere to any religion are entitled to believe that it represents the truth, but that wasn't his point. His point was that Christians have contributed in these societies for millennia, not just centuries, for millennia. They've contributed economically, intellectually, politically. If you drain the Middle East of Christians, you are harming the Middle East, you're harming Iraq and Syria, you're harming Islam and Muslims and other religious communities that are minorities within this country. And he laid this out, I think, in a very good way. For the United States, the answer to this question, it seems to me, is stability. If we allow the Middle East to be drained of its minorities, including Christians, we are allowing it to become nothing more than a training ground for terrorism, the kind of terrorism that has already struck our beloved country and will continue to do so if we do not develop a more effective response to it. And so how do we save the Christians, of course, is a terribly difficult and multifaceted The answer to that is multifaceted, and I'm perfectly willing to say not just how do we save the Christians, but the Yazidis, the Mandeans, the other minorities, the Shia minority, or pluralism, cultural and religious pluralism, because without it, the Middle East becomes a training ground for terrorism. So I'd like to talk to you just a little bit about some of the options, some of which are less bad than others. All of them are tough. It first begins with military action against ISIS that, in my view, needs to be more effective than the military action that is now going on. This is not a talk about military action, but I do believe that what I am going to talk to you about is impossible as long as ISIS continues to exist, to flourish, to draw to itself others to from the United States and elsewhere around the world to spread to other countries, not only of the Middle East. The military action against ISIS can have what our friend Chris Seipel calls, what is the phrase he uses? It's a theostrategic, I think is the word he uses. He likes to put these things together. His point is, if you can drive back this caliphate, take territory away from it, you're not only taking territory away from an army, but you are disputing the theological basis for its existence, which is territory in this particular case. But I said I don't want to talk about that. Let me move on for it. Because if you kill all of these people, there's still an idea that will survive. It's the idea that exists in ISIS in Libya and elsewhere around the world. It's the idea that exists in Al-Qaeda, Al-Nusra, Boko Haram, the Taliban, certain versions of the Muslim Brotherhood, not the one that was represented in Tina's meetings, certain versions of Wahhabism. Here's the idea, the commonality. If you offend Islam, you deserve violent punishment. You have to kill that idea in order to save Christians and other minorities in the Middle East. And the only way this can be done is not by you and me, those of us who are here today who are not Muslims, and even the Muslims are here in this country that are here in this room. This has to be killed, this idea, by the stakeholders of Islam. But in order to do that, they have to have what Tina and Hardwired are trying to give them, and that is religious freedom. They must be able to speak out about their own religion in their own country. There are many Islams, and this is what they lack today. Now, let's talk a little bit about what the Christians and the Yazidis and the other minorities that are the subjects of genocide, and I agree with, I didn't hear Congressman Wolf talk about it, but I'm sure he's happy that the United States has adopted this resolution on genocide. I heard Tina say it. I think it's a terribly important rhetorical step. Rhetoric has consequences when it's followed by action. What can be done for the Christians that is not military? We have to talk about a post-ISIS future. Pray that it comes. Or a future in which ISIS, at least as a military force, has been shrunk and circumvented, if not completely destroyed. What do we do for the Christians and the others? One way to help them is help them leave. And I know many people, probably some in this room, and I know my colleagues here on the panel know people, who are heavily engaged in this. And I applaud what they're doing. I believe that Christians and others who want to flee their homes have a right to do so. They certainly have a reason to do so, the horrors that they've experienced. But emptying the Middle East of its minorities is not the solution to the problem that I am talking about. So hear me, I would never, ever say to any human being that's in a position of such suffering, no, you have to stay. But there are those that want to stay. There are those in these camps and trailer groups that Frank and Tina have talked about who are surviving. They have enough food, they have enough shelter, but they are traumatized. They cannot work. They cannot get jobs. They cannot take care of their families. They have to rely on the aid of others. They can't drive. They can't move. They are in a terrible situation. The pressure on them to try to leave is enormous. So, in my view, what we must be doing now is planning for their future beyond simply keeping them alive. And in order to do this, we have to think about these terribly difficult questions. And they're really, I mean, conceptually, it is not complicated. Most of them, many of them, are in Kurdistan, which Tina was talking about, the northern part of Iraq, the Kurdish part of Iraq. I'm delighted to hear that she is working with many of the Kurdish leaders. Many of the Christians who are living in Kurdistan are suspicious of the Kurds. But clearly, this has got to be one of the potential answers. Many of them are living in Kurdistan. Why can't we develop or help the Kurds develop a system in which they can truly be integrated into that society? It would still be possibly part of Iraq. It's unclear what will happen to Kurdistan. There's a lot of geopolitics here. But simply the law of inertia would suggest that one solution is to help them stay where they are now, but get out of these, in essence, these caravans, these camps, where they cannot live their lives as Christians. They can worship in a private sense, but they cannot live their lives as Christians. Another would be to move back to their homes elsewhere in Iraq, in Baghdad and elsewhere. Boy, we're a long way from that happening. And I know I haven't been to Iraq as both these people have, Tina and Frank, but I know from having listened to those who have that there are many Christians and others who will never go back to their homes, even if they're given the opportunity, because they are traumatized. Their neighbors have betrayed them. Think of this. Think of your family being driven out of your homes. And even if you have an opportunity. Your next-door neighbors, who you've lived with for 20 or 30 years, betrayed you to ISIS. Would you move back? Could you just reconcile, forget? Those of you who are Christians have a theology to do that, but that's pretty tough. There's a third one that I happen to favor, but it's just as hard as the others. It's a protected zone. There are many ways to think about this. You could think of Kurdistan itself as a protected zone, but the one that I talk most about is called the Nineveh Plain Protected Zone. This, of course, would require military action before you could even talk about it, because most of the Nineveh Plain is now controlled by ISIS. But the idea would be to build a community, not just of Christians and not just of minorities, but any member of, frankly, Iraq or Syria, a citizen who's been displaced, who's willing to play by the rules, which is that, really, the rules of religious freedom. Now, it's easy to say this. Security has to be taken care of. You have to have an international force. You have to have a police force. You have to have governance. You have to deal with the trauma these people have been through. You have to deal with reconciliation, because we're talking about a society of different religious groups. We're not talking about a Christian enclave, at least in my view. This would be the model for the kind of community that I see that Tina is trying to build, a model of perhaps democratic governance that could spread to the rest of Iraq. Well, let me just end by saying, you know, why would anybody want to do such a hard thing? Why would anybody even want to think about this? People are dying and suffering all over the world. We're not talking about them now. We're not talking about North Korea, which is the poster child. We're not even talking about too much about Sudan, although it's been mentioned. Some things have been done in Sudan to help those people. There are terrible places around the world where the United States is not doing something. But we have to act in the Middle East because of our own interest, if for no other reason. It's not just because you or I may be Christians. I happen to be a Catholic. As I said, I have no problem arguing for my brothers and sisters in Christ. I do not hesitate to do it. But the argument for the United States government is that this is a national security issue for us. If we allow Iraq and Syria to continue to degenerate without acting effectively, not just militarily, but in terms of creating a post-ISIS environment that can be stable, then we are harming your children and your grandchildren and mine. We have a responsibility that is moral and humanitarian on one side and involves national security of our country on the other. And I would say that's just as moral a responsibility for all of us. So the stakes could not be higher about what we're talking about today. I'll stop with that. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Farr, for your work and your comments here today. Let's take some questions now before we conclude for the day. Who has a question? I think we'll have a mic that'll rove around just so we can get that. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Penny with CNS News. Congressman Wolf, There was a lot of reports in the media in February about the girls who had been kidnapped, or not just at that one instance, but ongoing kidnapping and abuse. That one of the problems of their coming back was that many of them had children or were pregnant, and that their families were rejecting them because of that. And even under these horrible circumstances, many of these young women wanted to keep their children. Can you comment on that? Did you have any experience in that area?
Only the one counselor that spoke to us, who was counseling the families of the Chichibok girls. But that's why, if you read the Washington Post piece, I believe you need to send over IJM and Polaris and Shared Hope to sort of see, because these women and girls will have been victims twice. They're victims when they're taken, and of course abused, and then they're victims when they try to come home. And there are ways. IJM, Gary Hogan, has done a tremendous job with regard to reintegrating. In Northern Virginia, there were 81 places where young girls and women were sexually trafficked. Polaris and IJM did have great programs for rehabilitation, bringing them back. So I think we in the United States, particularly when the White House said, hashtag bring back our girls, and the world made such a big deal of it, I think we now have a moral obligation. So that's one of the recommendations we're going to make, is that you send a team over to work with the Nigerian government to put together a program to help bring these girls and women back to integrate into their villages. But there are problems. There are very serious problems, because some believe that, I won't repeat what it, you've read the story, but that there's a problem to bring them back. But I think you can develop a program that would enable them to come back. And we should be involved with it.
Mark Meadows' office. Two quick prongs around fostering a culture of religious liberty in the Middle East. First for Mr. Farr, and then second, Mrs. Ramirez. So on the first prong, something like the Nineveh Plain Protected Zone, have we ever seen a model like that foster the kind of protected freedom that you hope to see? Has it ever worked elsewhere, particularly between fierce religious traditions that just they don't mix well together? And then secondarily, Mrs. Ramirez, the caliber of culture shapers that you've managed to attract to your trainings is astounding. I mean, the folks from the Muslim Brotherhood, judges, folks who are writing and making the law, how have you managed to attract that caliber of kind of what I would view as maybe the Muslim magisterium in Iraq, and you're getting them all there and having powerful conversations and trainings together? How are you attracting these people? We got to replicate that.
Well, the answer is there have been plenty of protected zones where people of different religions have gotten along. One is the United States. There is absolutely no inevitability. You mean about a out of a war zone, that sort of thing. It's a good question. I don't want to be flip about it. Let me think about it a little bit. Maybe I'll get back to you. I think there are protected zones that have failed because of insufficient support and care and international funding, a whole bunch of things. As I said very quickly, this is very hard, and the only reason anybody's right mind would think about it is the stakes. The stakes are the loss of Christianity and Christians in Iraq and Syria and the national security of the United States. And if I might just make a brief editorial, there is a law called the Frank Wolf International Religious Freedom Act that is making its way through the House as we speak. It's an amendment to a law that Congressman Wolf was indispensable in passing back in 1998, the International Religious Freedom Act, which in my view, the amendment would fix a number of problems in the State Department and would focus us on this national security issue. And this is, I think, being held up, and it's a bipartisan opposition, if I can put it this way, because, gosh, we don't want to spend any money on foreign affairs. And in order to elevate the guy that would run this, the ambassador at large, it would cost a little bit of money, a few million dollars. We're talking about national security here. A few million dollars, less than one drone, probably half of one drone, that might save the blood and treasure of the United States, is worth spending a little bit of money, even on foreign affairs. That's not just the Democrats. I don't know where your boss stands on this, but I'd like to preach to him if he has a vote. He's not on the Foreign Affairs Committee, I don't believe. Anyway, so this is important. So, yeah, it's hard. I mean, the press, has it ever worked? No. I'm not going to say, Cyprus and there are other UN kind of – I'm talking about doing something. It may be new. If you can think of a better answer, I'd like to hear it.
Thanks, Tom. It's a great question, and I guess the first answer would be a lot of prayer. I don't think that I worked on the Hill as well. I started the International Religious Freedom Caucus for Congressman Franks when I was there years ago, and it was an idea of Congressman Wolf's when I first started about a decade ago there. So that it's frustrating working on the Hill and seeing these problems constantly come up and never being able to really solve them. You're just kind of constantly putting out fires because you have so much on your plate. And I felt like that. So when I left the Hill, I prayed a lot about God, what God wanted me to do, because I wanted to be a problem solver. And I knew that these people in the countries where we were working needed help on the ground where they were. They didn't need it 2 years late after there was a genocide. And for years, I'd been doing a lot of this work in Iraq, and I felt very frustrated that, you know, the briefings, the hearings, nothing was getting through to Obama or even Bush, and the same problems were, but we saw this happening. I mean, you could have heard, read any of Congressman Wolf's speeches. He predicted it. You know, and we could see it happening in Nigeria. We could see it happening in Pakistan. We would love to be working there. I mean, there are so many places you can see. It's a really easy kind of bellwether to know when religious oppression is getting so bad that you're going to see these kinds of things happen. So because I worked in the Congress and I had a huge network that I'm sure you're building as well, I was able to meet a lot of great people that over the years have become my partners now in countries where we're working. And so we have a really great partner in Iraq who's he's William Warda with the Hammurabi Human Rights Organization. And he leads coalitions of a lot of different religious communities there and people. We had other partners that we've worked with there as well, so that we try to get as diverse networks as possible so we can bring a lot of different people in. At first, the Kurdish government was actually a little afraid of me because I helped get a pastor released from there after 2 years of them holding him. So I hope that doesn't go on the record here. But I think they've warmed up a little bit. And in a few weeks, we're actually going to be bringing a man that the Kurdish government has just appointed as a representative to the Jewish community in Kurdistan, which, I mean, how many of you thought there were Jews left in Iraq, right? I thought there were five. Well, there are five. They're in Baghdad. But in northern Iraq, there's actually hundreds of families of Jews that have been living in hiding with their ID cards saying Muslim. And the Kurdish government appointed a man who's representing them now and who's working to change that. And we're working with him to help him do that. So we would love for you to, if the congressman wants to meet him and get to know him, and you can be a part of helping us too. So there are a lot of ways that all of you can be a part of this. And I'm about solutions and finding ways to get everybody to get things done. You know, it's been going on for a long time, but I've seen in a little time I've worked in Iraq since I left the Hill that we actually can make a difference. We just have to start, because the more we talk about it, nothing gets done. But if we do something, it will get done. And, you know, I know that the Bible says there will always be persecution, but I know that Paul and Christ were big advocates for standing for those brothers and sisters that are in chains and at least doing what we can in the positions that we have.
I just say what Tom and Tina are talking about is very, very doable. When we were there, we visited a military unit in the Nineveh Plains of men who have come back from all over the world. There were a few Americans. There were a lot of from England and different places. They're working out. They're training. They have all weapons. And there was an 11 amendment, Senator 11, who since left the Congress, that called for the arming of these groups. So I think what Tom is talking about, a Nineveh Plains protective unit, the Yazidis want it. I think the Kurds would allow it. So I think it's very doable. And I would hope this Congress, I think there's going to be a resolution or a bill put in, would really pass it. Because otherwise, we will see there's a group out of England, I think it's called ICAN, that predicted in 6 years you will see no Christians left in the cradle of Christendom. So I think what Tom is proposing and Tina is very, very doable, and I think it ought to be done.
Well, and it's important to know it's already in Iraqi law this should happen. This is not a new idea. I mean, when we were there 2 years ago, we came back and we said basically in January of 2014, so right before ISIS came in, the Iraqi parliament actually debated the provision in the constitution that was supposed to allow the Nineveh Plains to become autonomous. The Kurds pushed it down at the time, and it hasn't been brought up since, obviously, since ISIS overran the area, and then the other parts of Iraq, they weren't able to really have, you know, control the country to do anything. But it's already in law. It's already something that that should be determined, and so it's really a matter of U.S. leadership to get it done so that they can have the area where they have access to their own resources, to their own oil, because that will bring them the income to actually have a government, to do a number of things. So it's in law already.
Other questions?
Well, I want to start, Mr. Wolf, by thanking you for finally going to Nigeria.
It was Luann that really kind of did all the work.
I know that in your 3 decades in Congress, you wanted to go, and you finally went in your retirement, and you went to places that I can assure you the U.S. Embassy would not have let you go if you went as a congressman. So I thank you for your courage. I also want to thank everyone on the panel for your consistency over the years in your fellowship of suffering with us in Nigeria and the rest of the world. I did want to say that we've had these forums and we've talked about these issues. And whenever our brethren on the other side meet like this, they come out of a session with someone agreeing to strap a bomb on themselves and go out and kill infidels. My question is this: how can we have a broad strategy where we're looking at it not country by country, but as a global phenomenon? Because a lot of the things you've shared today are things that are happening in Nigeria. When you talk about the Nazarene tag, we had the Katab sign on the homes of Christians in Yobe in 2011, and they were going out and killing them. So it's the same MO. So I think there's a real need for us to have a global response strategy about the what the Pope has called the Third World War, which is happening almost incrementally or installmentally. Now, I also want to probably endorse your position that we need a Christian response from the body of Christ and an intervention in Nigeria. Because if we're waiting on this administration, it's not going to happen. And so we need the world visions and all the Christian charities to be able to respond to that crisis. We don't see that happening. I think the final thing I want to mention here is you referred, Congressman, to the Washington Post article. There was a nuanced statement there that was very unfortunate. The Washington Post said that the Muslims in northern Nigeria resent the federal government because it is dominated by Christians. Now, this is a complete fallacy. We have a president who is Muslim, a government that is dominated by Muslims. But this is what the State Department and the media is saying to try and justify the injustices against Christians in Nigeria. And it takes missions like yours to see what is happening on the ground, to bring the truth to the American public. So once again, I thank you all for what you're doing. But my question is, how can we have a holistic response to what is clearly a global problem? Because whether we like it or not, a year ago, ISIS and Boko Haram have merged operations, which is why in your speech you refer to them as ISIS. And we need to have a response to that. I thank you.
Let's we'll take that question, but if we have one more question, we'll bunch them together and then answer them in order to conclude for the day. So,
this is a question for Mr. Rafique. To sort of go into your comments a little bit more with respect to the current administration, what kind of response are you getting from the Obama administration regarding how most effectively to handle the issue of the emerging Sharia that you talked about in Pakistan?
Thank you very much. Right now, we are very much, upset, and because from last 12 years, United States Commission for International Freedom, they put their recommendation to the State Department, but still they are not taking any action regarding this. Diplomatically, they are trying to reach them, but the government of Pakistan playing a dual policy, a tactics with them. So because of political will and fear and because of pro-Talibanization mindset, so they are influenced, as a government, they are influenced by the religious organizations in Pakistan. So America maybe have their own strategy in that area, which harms them or which blocks them. They are not going to act on their own institution recommendations. But as for government concerns, Pakistani government are not responding practically for the protection, promotion of religious freedom or its citizen, and especially Christians and minorities in Pakistan.
Did you want to address Emmanuel's question, Tina? Or?
Sure.
or someone, whoever, feel free to address that, and then I'll conclude.
I completely agree with you, Emmanuel. I think that I'm a big picture person, so I'd love to take a global perspective on this. The reality is just that it's hard to get a lot of people around the table to really do that. And then once you do, and we saw this in Congress, and we had all of the different groups come to us, but they would never work together. So it's a pretty difficult thing to do. That's not what we try to do. We actually try to do something very simple in one place, one person at a time, one community at a time, one country at a time, and allow that ripple to spread out throughout that country. And we've seen that it's powerful, because we found that when we look at the big picture and we try to, you know, get everybody on board with these big concepts and ideas, then nothing really happens because no one has their action points to go out and to do something. But if you can be successful in one place, you can use that model and begin to send those ripples across to different countries. I don't think that this administration will ever take it seriously, but I'm hopeful that if we could at least do something successful now, others will begin to see it and model it. I felt the same way in Nigeria. I think also when you're working at the big picture level, you're not changing the hearts and minds of the people on the ground that are responsible for responding to persecution daily. And until we change the hearts and minds of the people in Nigeria, the people in Iraq, the people in Sudan, or any other country where persecution, Pakistan, is rampant, you won't see any changes. I mean, I'm sure that Pervez feels very frustrated as a government leader that he can't change things. He has other government officials that have taken really tough stands in defense of Asia Bibi, who's still in prison and been murdered for it. Until the hearts, minds of the people change, he's going to have a constant uphill battle. And so we need to stand alongside him to change that within Pakistan, within Iraq, within all of these different countries, to really see that change happen. And that takes a lot of work, but I can tell you that the amount of money it costs us to do this is minimal compared to the billions that we spend on the weapons in those same countries. And unfortunately, we're probably going to be a lot more successful, and the people that maybe would have been influenced by ISIS from our trainings aren't. They're going to go the opposite direction. But you throw the bombs, they're going to start fighting. So I think it's a perspective.
Go ahead. No, you go ahead.
Well, I would just say that in order to have a global strategy, you have to agree there's a global problem, and there is no agreement.
That's true.
Certainly the administration doesn't believe there's a global problem, but you have to call things by their names. I think what you meant, and I would agree with you if this is what you meant, there is a global threat of radical Islamist extremism, violent Islamist extremism. It threatens not only the United States, Christians, Muslims, and atheists, but it threatens Islam. And the greatest victims numerically are Muslims to this kind of stuff. Now, you have to talk about that. You can't defeat any enemy if you aren't willing to talk about it. So that's step one, and we haven't even taken that step. But then once you do, there's the question of how you develop such a strategy. It would be multifaceted. It would have military elements, but religious freedom would have to be part of this. And our religious freedom bureaucracy is, while it has excellent leadership at the moment, is not bureaucratically integrated into the State Department. It has very little authority, even fewer resources. It couldn't lead, play a big role in this strategy. It would have to if it's going to work, because religious freedom's got to be part of it. So it's a tough thing. I agree with you, and as I said before, I think there's not much more important that faces us, and I'm baffled. And frankly, I don't know what's going to happen when we have a new president, because I don't know who that will be, and I don't know how they will approach this problem. So there's a great deal of uncertainty, but the one thing we can't do is give up. We cannot. We have to keep fighting. Congressman.
Well, I agree with the Pope. We are in World War III. And frankly, more congressional delegations used to go out and see. You walk through these camps and hear the stories of the girls. You hear the Yazidi girls, you go to Tahuk, and so we are in World War III. Secondly, President Reagan said the words in the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence were a covenant, not only with the people in Philadelphia in 1776 and 87, but with the entire world. We are violating the covenant. And so I have no confidence this administration will do anything. But this Congress ought to have extensive hearings. There is a connection between Boko Haram. He pledged it to ISIS. There is a connection to al-Shabaab in Somalia. There is a connection with what's taking place in Libya. I mean, we saw what took place in France. We saw what took place in San Bernardino. We are in World War III, and so the Congress should be dealing with this. Forget the administration, holding extensive hearings, bringing people in, bringing the best political minds in, the best military minds in, and dealing with this. We will pay the price. We will pay it now, or we will pay it later. Lastly, everything that takes place in government and in Congress is downstream from the culture. So if the Congress isn't hearing from the American people, if the administration isn't hearing from the American people, and, you know, we just do not have a leader like we had in President Reagan or in Winston Churchill or in President Kennedy or in President Truman. Do you think if this was taking place during the Truman administration, President Truman would just be doing nothing? Of course he would be doing something. And so would the Congress. So we're going to face it. I mean, people are going to, I mean, this is coming. You remember, what did Martin Luther King say? He says something to the effect, silence in the face of evil is evil itself. You know, not to speak is to speak, not to act is that. If we don't speak and we don't act, we are saying we really don't care. They are coming, and they are coming to kill people, and we are in World War III. And so the administration and the Congress has to deal with it, or else some very bad things are going to happen in the world.
We have addressed a lot of policy today, a lot of discussion of law and policy and what can be done in addition to the culture that needs to be behind it. You know, and the one last observation I have in this sort of address is Emmanuel's point, and is good to follow Mr. Wolf's comments, is that the other thing that needs to happen, one component of this, is that American Christians in American churches have to care about what happens to Christians overseas. There has to be a heart connection there. There has to be solidarity. There has to be feeling of or perception of when they do something to a Christian in Iraq that hurts me, just like when they do something to a Christian next door. This has to happen. It has to be, you know, part of the push that will generate attention and focus that will drive policy and cultural changes. You know, to this end, Family Research Council is hosting a Stand with the Persecuted Sunday, April 17th. This is a chance for American churches to say, we are going to focus on what's happening to the brothers and sisters overseas and pray for them. Here are stories like that of Damaris. Her story is put together on Open Doors. It's available on YouTube. You can see it. This type of thing has to happen as part of the overall attention on the issue. As we attempt to stand for and protect religious freedom as a human right to have your beliefs, choose your beliefs, change your beliefs, and live them out wherever that is in the world for all faiths. As Christians, we support that. Thank you all for coming, and thank you to our panelists today. We really appreciate you being here. Let's give everyone a hand. Just before we conclude today, I just thought it was appropriate. Tina's comments reminded me just to pray for our work and ask for God's blessing on our work before we conclude today. So let me just close in a word of prayer. God, we thank you for all the folks who are here today, the effort that goes into addressing protection for people to live out their faith freely. And we ask that your blessing will be on the efforts of those people here today who are working so hard on the issue. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for coming today. Feel free to mingle with the panelists and everyone before you leave. Amen.